Hello everyone. I'm Amila Maha. I'm a senior tech lead in WSO2. If you haven't heard about WSO2, WSO2 is an open source middleware company. At the moment, I'm the lead of the cloud team. So in this session, what I'm going to share with you is the experience we had when building our public cloud, which we called WSO2 Cloud. So in the last maybe 2 or 2.5 years, we have been bringing it up from the scratch. And at the moment, it's in a stable position. Some components are in beta and some are in commercial. So I'll be sharing the pain points and the challenges we had. And maybe you might not be planning to run a public cloud by yourself, but if you are going to handle a deployment, a big deployment, some of these tips might help you in the future. So I would like to see how many of you have heard about WSO2 Cloud. Okay, that's good. I thought none of the hands might go up. So the WSO2 Cloud is the public cloud solution from WSO2. The specialty is it is built using only using the WSO2 middleware. So that's the challenge. So middleware is, you know, somewhat rough edge stuff. They don't have these fancy looking UIs and all those things. And the other thing is WSO2 has, it's been known as a middleware company, and the challenge for us was to get these middleware products and build a public cloud where the end users can easily use for their purposes, right? So this is WSO2 Cloud UI. I'll quickly get off from the slides and go to cloud. So if you go to wso2.com/cloud, you see that same UI. And if you don't have an account, you can sign up by providing your email. Or you can, if you have a wso2.com account, you can sign in. So after you sign in, so since this works with single sign-on and I had previously logged in, it just took me to the inside page. So we have an app cloud and an API cloud at the moment. The API cloud is powered by WSO2 API Manager, which has become very popular in the API management community. And the app cloud is powered by WSO2 App Factory, which is a new product. So you know that by the name of it, API cloud can be used for creating and hosting your APIs and manage them. And the app cloud can be used for app development, and it supports, it provides cradle to grave support for your app. So you can start from the scratch and you can promote your app from dev to test to production environments and host your app in production. So we provide the database facilities, cloud IDE, and a lot of those facilities. So this is the app cloud UI, and this is the API cloud UI. So it says my trial has expired. That's because we recently went commercial with the API cloud. So I'll go back to the slides. Right. So let me briefly explain the motivation behind building the public cloud. So about 3 years back, we had another public cloud solution. We named it as Stratos Live. The reason was we had a product called Stratos, and that product, the task of that product was to get all the WSO2 middleware products and make it as a service. Because we say WSO2 is a complete platform, and with Stratos Live, what we did was we made that platform available as a service, so it was a PaaS. But we realized there were some limitations of that one. One was like it was very difficult for users to get into the cloud and use it because it was not very intuitive. We had made the rough UI of our products available for the users. So because of that, like it was difficult for them. And the other thing was the users were asking like, okay, whether we can host PHP applications, whether we can host Node.js applications in this one, So although we exposed about like 8 to 9 products in that platform, people were mostly interested in app hosting. So because of that, because of those limitations, the company decided to do an architectural revisit on Stratos, and they came up with Stratos 2.0, which was which supported like not only the WSO2 products but also the other applications like PHP, Node.js, and all those containers. And then, since it was successful and it was gaining momentum, they decided to host donate it to Apache, and it became Apache Stratos. So once we donate something to Apache, we can't use those names and those trademarks, and so we can't use them. So we had to shut down Stratos Live. And at the same time, so we were looking at providing a better user experience for our users, and also the API Manager product was becoming popular. So we were wondering, okay, like what if we bring the API Manager product to the cloud? And then, so we were, a couple of our guys were sitting together, and we were discussing about these how the UI should be for them, because the UI should be intuitive and all those important user experience and those stuff. Then at the same time, in somewhere else in the company, they were coming up with a product called WSO2 App Factory, which was supporting for app creation. And we realized, okay, our use cases and the App Factory features are somewhat similar, so we decided to use WSO2 App Factory to power the App Cloud. So that's how we started building it. And at the beginning, we built it as a preview. So a preview means like there's no guarantee for the users that your data will be there. We might clean it time to time. So that's the nature of a preview. So we ran it for like 6 months as a preview, and then launched it as a beta in 2014 June, and then we kept it in beta for 1 year, and the App Cloud is still in beta because we are still we want to improve some parts of the App Cloud, but the API Cloud we launched. Commercially launched the API Cloud. So if you want now, you can go to the API Cloud and create an account, and you can like start using it. So so this is basically the information I mentioned on like how we started it and where we are at the moment. Now I'll come to the war stories now. So first of all, why it's a war? So like if you felt that okay, we are fighting, no such things, right? But it's difficult because first thing is like this is a live system, and we have a lot of instances, so we have to keep an eye on them, and we need to provide high availability for our services, and most importantly, we can't let a bug to exist in the system for a long time. We know there aren't bug-free software. So in the software or the middleware we use to build this cloud, there are bugs. So time to time, we find out these bugs. And when we find a bug, we have to fix it as soon as possible, because or else some user might get affected with those. The other thing is we can't let it run with old versions of the products for a long time, because we need to upgrade them frequently. If the API Manager version 1.9 is released and we are running with 1.8, then users start asking, okay, when are you going to upgrade for 1.9? We need this feature. Okay, we are telling, okay, that feature is in the next release. Okay, when are you going to upgrade to that one? So we need to upgrade frequently. And the biggest challenge is we depend on other WSO2 products, but for those teams, so there are different product teams, for those teams, we are just another customer. So even though we run it within WSO2, we don't have much of a saying like, okay, we want this feature, you have to do it like this. So we have to come in the same way that our customers request features, and we have to file bugs and get them fixed. So we have to communicate with them, we have to show them, okay, architecturally this place is wrong because this is causing pains for us, and so we have to discuss with them and get things fixed. So because of all these challenges, it has been a challenging task. So during the session, I'll be sharing our experience on what are the customizations and the new development we have done, because like we can't just put up these middleware products and present to the user saying, okay, this is our cloud. We have to do some more work. And what things we considered when planning the deployment, and how we manage our configurations. Most importantly, monitoring and alerting we use, and bug fixing, upgrading and upgrades and migrations, security of the system and of security of the users' artifacts and their domains, then the backups and restorations, statistics, feedback and customer support, the most importantly, the performance issues and the processes we had to come up with when we were dealing with these things. So first thing was, we had to come up with a new user model. So before that, I will explain what was the old user model. So obviously, in a cloud, we have to provide multi-tenancy support. So in the left side of the diagram, we have the old tenant model, where if one person wanted to use in multiple organizations, so in this case, organization is equivalent to a tenant. If they wanted to use in multiple organizations, they had to remember three usernames and three passwords. So that's the default multi-tenancy support provided in the WSO2 products. But we realized this was not the case where, let's say, a freelance developer who has created an account in WSO2 Cloud, he might want to work in multiple organizations, but he don't want to mess up the two or three organizations. He wanted to work on them isolatedly. So we realized a user should be able to sign in to the cloud using their email, because like nowadays, like most of the cloud services, they just accept the email and they allow to create the accounts. So we realized we need to let them to sign in using the email, and then let them use the organizations they want to work on. So that was the new model we wanted to go. Because of that, so I'll go back. We had to come up with this new user model, and we had to implement a new user store. So in WSO2 products, we have a user store where the product we plug the product to the user store. And the other thing was, we wanted to plug the WSO2.com user base to the cloud. So at the beginning, I told you that if you have a WSO2.com account, you can log into WSO2 cloud, which means we have plugged the WSO2.com user store to our implementation. Because of that, we had to come up with a custom user store. The thing was, the WSO2 provided, the WSO2 code base provides extension points for us to come up with our own user store implementation. And then, so we were planning to come up with this API cloud and app cloud at the beginning. So we wanted a central place to manage. For example, okay, users they want to register, they want to add new members to their organization, they want to create new organizations. One user might want to work in multiple organizations, and then they might want to change their profile information. And later we added some more like the contact us methods and all those things. So we wanted a central place. Like we should lie independently of the app cloud and the API cloud, but should affect both the clouds. So we wanted a management app to manage these two clouds, and so we had to come up with that application as well. So these were the new development and the customizations we did. Then our next challenge was to plan the deployment. So I mentioned about our previous public cloud, previously hosted one, the Stratos Live. So we had experience in hosting this one in one of our data centers, or we had rented some machines in a US data center, and we had hosted the cloud there. And we realized it was a painful thing, because like we only have the VMs, and we had to do all the software installation and all those things. And then we have to take care about the backups and restorations, security, all those things, security of the infrastructure. So we had to take care of all those things. Because of that, we knew that we are not specialized in maintaining infrastructure. That's not our domain. And we had the previous experience. We knew what were the difficult tasks. So we decided to go with Amazon Web Services as our infrastructure provider. And we had some experience in using AWS previously as well. So we knew that they had the services like Amazon EC2, VPC, RDS is for relational data services, and they had this Route 53 service for creating DNS entries. So we don't have to maintain our own DNS stuff, so we could just configure using their services. Because of that, we decided to go with AWS as the infrastructure service. And the other thing was, now we knew, okay, we are going to set up an API cloud and the app cloud, and also there are going to be some common components for both of these. For example, the identity components, the statistics collecting components. So those are going to be common for both clouds. So for the entire deployment, we needed to provide high availability. So we had to plan the deployment like none of the components fail at a given time. So there should be at least two instances running in active mode. So we had to think about those things. But at the moment, there are still a couple of single point of failures in our deployment, which we are working on, getting rid of. So then the challenge was the configuration management. So when we planned the deployment, we were adding new nodes. Okay. Two API management nodes, two API gateway nodes, two identity nodes. So new things were coming. And so we had to configure all those things to work with each other. We know when we are dealing with any deployment, configuration becomes very important. If you mess your configuration, you will end up with the stuff not working because the API manager might not be able to talk to the identity server if you have configured a wrong URL. So in the previous experience, we were using some Subversion-based solution. So we were maintaining the configuration files in Subversion and only the configuration files. So we wanted to set up a new product. What we did was we copied the pack and then we took the configurations from the Subversion and copied them to the product. So we get the fresh product and copy the configurations and then we had the configured product. So that's the earlier one we were using. But we, that involved a lot of human work. For example, if you want to set up the instance in a new product in a new instance, so we had to copy the pack there and then copy the configurations and all those things. So at that time, we were playing with Puppet. So Puppet is from Puppet Labs, which is a very good tool for managing configurations. Some other factors we had to consider was, now AWS has a tendency of like shutting down their instances for maintenance. We get an email saying, okay, this instance you are using will be shut down on this day for maintenance or for upgrades, so you'll have to move your service to another instance. So they don't do it, we have to do it. So in that case, if we had to do it manually, we'll have to copy the pack to the new machine and, as I said, copy the configuration and do all those things. And we knew that we needed to scale this deployment. For example, if we realize we are getting high traffic for the API gateway, we might want to add a new instance. So those things has to be done quickly. And another important thing was we wanted to have multiple environments. So we can't just live with a live environment. We need a developer environment and a staging environment. So before we are applying a patch, we need to apply to the staging and then make sure it's working and then only we can go to live. So the staging environment should be identical to the live one. So because of that, there had to be a lot of maintenance on configuration management to be done. So considering this stuff, we decided to go with Puppet. And at the moment, now we are maintaining like more than 100 nodes, 100 AWS instances using Puppet. So whenever we want to set up a new, let's say, I make a request for my DevOps team saying, okay, we want a new API gateway added to the API gateway cluster, so they can do it in like 5 minutes. They have to just start an AWS instance and run some Puppet commands, and it will do the rest. So that's how we manage the configuration. And then when the deployment was growing, so we needed to have a way of like keep an eye on this. We needed monitoring and alerting. So initially, what the DevOps guys they do is they come up with these all the monitoring tools they have, these SNMP and Nagios, and they configure those things. So like then in their dashboard, you can see the instances and their CPU and memory consumption and all those things and the disk usage. So they also configure emails and phone alerts. So if something goes wrong, they get an email or a phone call or SMS. But that was not enough. For sometimes, if you take an instance, the API gateway instance or the API publisher instance, it might be up and running. The port check will say, okay, the port is up and running. The memory is okay, CPU is okay. But due to some reason, some functionality might have broken. Maybe the users are not able to create an API using the API publisher. So we don't know. We don't know that. Our dashboard say, okay, that's healthy. The instance is healthy. Because of that, we needed to have a functionality health check. So for that, we had to write our own heartbeat tool. So we call it heartbeat. We wrote our own heartbeat tool. What we did was, in that tool, we decided to invoke all the services or the features we want to monitor. So, for example, like periodically we try to log into the instances and check. Periodically we try to create an API and check. Periodically we invoke an API and check. So we are checking the different components of the deployment to check whether they are working. And so our VP of cloud, he also want to have statistics of the uptime, because people before when they are selecting a cloud, public cloud, they have a look at these uptime stats as well. So we added those features also in our the heartbeat monitoring tool. So at the moment, what we are doing is, let's say still we are sometimes getting incidents that some stuff are broken. So what we do is, like, we check, okay, whether we have a test for to identify that one. How did we identify that that it was not working? If it was not from a test, what we do is we create a Jira for our developers to add a test to check that functionality. So by the time, we'll be adding more and more tests, and it will cover all the features of the cloud. Even this was not enough, because sometimes, like, there were things like there were smelly stuff in the logs. So for some users, like, they were trying to invoke APIs and they were sending wrong keys. So when they tried to create the API, they were having some issues. So user errors were also there, and not only the user errors. There were some error logs which printed in the logs, which could cause potential trouble. So we needed to know about that one as well. So what we did was, we started using this tool called Logstash and Kibana from Elastic.co company. So we are using it. So what it does is, all our logs are published to the Logstash, and Kibana is the UI which allows us to monitor the logs. So in a given time period, we can see, okay, how many error logs are there, like from which component we got those error logs, what are the warning logs. So if we see an unnecessary error log or some suspicious error log, we can investigate on that one, and we can even file a Jira for the product team saying, okay, your product prints this log, and there's a potential bug, so you need to fix it. So it might be a problem with our deployment, so we don't know. So we investigate and we try to fix those potential bugs as well. So this is the UI of the heartbeat dashboard we created. I took this from the staging. This part is still not in production. So I took this one from staging. So we show the uptime and what are the failures we had, and also, like, we are getting false alarms as well. So we don't want the false alarms to affect our uptime. So we have a mechanism here at the right hand corner for make them false alarms and then make them as like non-incident. So this is just some part of the UI in our heartbeat tool. So then the important thing, bug fixing, upgrades, and migrations. Whenever we find a bug, I told you that we can't live with that one. And I also mentioned that we are a customer of WSO2. Only thing is, like, we are not paying them. So what we do is we raise a support Jira for them, and we get patches for those issues. So that's how we fix bugs. Sometimes, like since we are also from the same company, we also have the capability to identify the bug and fix it by ourselves because we are familiar with the code base. In those cases, we sometimes quickly fix it, but we get the official patch from the support team. And then comes the upgrades and migrations. Now, the thing is, since App Factory is like still evolving, there are still rough edges, bleeding edges, so we need to get them fixed. But we can't wait like 6 months for a new release to come, and then we deploy that in live. So what we have done is, like we are working with that team, the App Factory team, to deploy their milestone packs in every 2 or 3 weeks. So we get the milestone packs, we try it in staging setup. Since this is a distributed deployment, it's not just updating one pack. There are many other places where we have to upgrade. So there are some OSGI components. So that all the WSO2 products are based on OSGI componentized architecture. So there are some other OSGI components which we have copied to other products. So we have to update them. And sometimes these milestone deployments, they end up in migrations. So we need to do data migrations for existing users, otherwise things will fail for them. So they provide us migration scripts, or we write our own migration scripts, and we write them in staging, and once we make sure that everything is working, we push the changes to live. So so there are some interesting ways we do it, I'll show it in the next slide. So at the moment, our target is to do continuous deployment. So we are planning to practice the same thing with the API Manager product for API Cloud, and then finally to do continuous deployment, like building nightly, deploying nightly builds to the deployment. But we are not there yet. We are working on getting there. So this is I'll explain like how sometimes we do the migrations. Now recently, we upgraded from API Manager 1.7 to 1.8 version. Now that involved a huge migration because they had changed the Swagger version used in API Manager product. Swagger is used for this API documentation purposes. We had the challenge of migrating all our tenants. There were like 2,500 tenants in the system we had to migrate. So one option was, the obvious option was to announce a downtime and run the migration, and it will run for like more than 24 hours. But we couldn't afford that. We couldn't afford a 24-hour downtime. We can only afford like 5 minutes, 10 minutes downtime. Can't go beyond that one. So what we did was, we decided to automate the migration stuff and add it to an OSGI component and copy it to the product. Since all the products are, the product is based on OSGI, once we copy the OSGI component, that will start running. So what we did was, you see these two green boxes are, so let's say this is a cluster of this is a cluster of API gateway or the API manager, API publisher. So these two are the nodes, the nodes which are serving the traffic. So these are exposed to the public. What we did was, we started another node and added it to the cluster, and we just copied that the jar which is doing the migration to that node. So the setup is running and the migration is happening in the background. So after like 7-8 hours, the migration completes, and so without with zero downtime, we were able to do the migration. So this is something now we are doing in practice. So any kind of these migrations, we are going to follow the same practice. So there might be some migrations which we can't follow this, like we need we'll have to adopt other ways. But this has now become a popular method between our teams. Then we needed to think about security. So one is the security of the infrastructure. So we have a developers team and a DevOps team. So normally we get access for the DevOps guys and not for the developers, right? So that was limited using the AWS features. So since we are since our deployment is done in AWS VPC, we have to like even to log in even to SSH to a machine, we have to go to an intermediate host and SSH from there. So that kind of security is provided for the infrastructure. And then, so let's, there are like 10, 12 10 or 12 WSO2 products used in this deployment. But some of them are like background products. They don't appear to the public. So the products which appear to the public is the API manager and App Factory. So so we wanted to hide the others from public. They can't access them because they shouldn't. So we did that one using the DNS stuff and the load balancing. And the other thing was securing users' data. So let's say I go and create an application in App Cloud. Now, our tenant model is a shared tenancy model. So in one application server, we deploy all the tenants' application. They are like isolated. So if I log into the App Cloud, I don't see others' applications, and they don't see my application. So we have that isolation. But we wanted to make sure that none of the users, like at least, try to programmatically access others' artifacts. So for that, we enabled the Java Security Manager. So when the Java Security Manager is enabled, it is very strict. So we can define the policies. So at the moment, the security policy is very strict, which sometimes causing troubles for us and users as well. So the problem is, like, let's say someone can deploy an application to read the files in the file system. So we have restricted them. And they can't create class loaders. So those kind of restrictions are there. But the reason is we are sharing the runtime with multiple tenants. That's the reason for having this strict policy. What we are going to do is, we are using Apache Stratos to host these application servers. So we are waiting for the next release of Apache Stratos, such that we can provide an instance each for each tenant. So we are going to use the Docker technology. And we can start multiple instances in one AWS instance. And then we can allow one tenant to have their own server. So then we can remove these security policies because, like, they have their own container, so they can't access others. So that's the security stuff. And then, importantly, we need to backup stuff. So we have the LDAPs, we have the databases, we have the users' artifacts. If some of these get lost, like, we can't recover them, and users will come back and ask, okay, I created an application, now it's missing. So all the users' artifacts are in either JIT or SVN. So we have this artifact distribution model where we first committed to JIT or SVN. At the moment, we are using JIT. And then it is taken by the app servers and deployed. So even the app servers were killed. If the AWS instance was killed, and if we start a new instance, that starts with the applications which are in the JIT repository. So they are not getting lost. And we take backups of those repositories. And we use Amazon RDS and EBS volumes. EBS volumes are the storage volumes where we plug to AWS instances. So all these, we have automated taking snapshots of those instances using the AWS features. And for LDAPs, we take frequent backups because LDAP is hosted by us, so we have to take backups. So if something goes wrong, we can restore from these backups, and these backups get updated weekly. And then we needed to know what's happening in the system. So in the earlier days, in Stratos Live, we had hosted the cloud, and we didn't know how the users were using it. We didn't know whether they were able to use it or whether they had issues. So we wanted to know, like, what they are doing, what's happening, are they failing, or they are succeeding. So we decided. We started publishing user events or the things users do to our one of our products called the WSO2 Business Activity Monitor. So we publish events, and those are stored in Cassandra by the WSO2 BAM, and we write our own analytics scripts, and then we see, okay. So in the past week, there have been like 50 users logged into the App Cloud, and from those 50 users, 35 has been able to create an application and launch it. Then we are thinking, what happened to the other 15? So, like, we can reach out to them and ask, okay, did you have any issues? If you want any help, you can ask us, so we can help them. So that's why we decided to track the user activities. And we are also tracking uptime, and we are also tracking the logs, the errors in the logs, and see like whether there's a trend of errors getting increased or whether it's in a constant state. So ideally there shouldn't be any errors, but still there are errors in the logs. So we are tracking them as well. And then, so we wanted the users, like, so sometimes the UIs are not intuitive. We are still working on that one. And when they try to use it, they might have issues, they might have problems, and they might want to contact us. So at the beginning, we didn't have a way. So what we did was we added a feature for them to contact us by using the UI, which will trigger an email. And not only an email, which will trigger a Jira as well in our system. So we know that, okay, this user needs help. So we reply to them, and we also keep working in the Jira. And until the user is satisfied, we can't close the Jira. And we have also added a feature that they are, where they can ask questions in Stack Overflow, because we do things openly. So we monitor these user issues, and we try to keep them informed once every day or once every 2 days. So they get they know like we are working on this. For example, like I said that our security policy is very strict because of that. Like if a user uploads a web app with some jars in that one, and it might fail because of the security manager. For example, there were days like earlier days, like they couldn't upload the Spring app because of the security permissions, it was failing. So the solution we come up for that was we decided to bundle the Spring jars in the application server and asked users to not to bundle them and use our one. So so when users ask for help on those kind of things, like they came to us using our feedback channel. The performance was another concerning issue. So when the number of tenants were increasing, that means the data was increasing, and we started seeing slowness. We started seeing slowness in a couple of places. One is the single sign-on. It took some time, and then app creation and API creation took time. So we started digging into our code, and we found out some architectural limitations or some reasons in the architecture. So we talked with the product teams and asked them to change the architecture. And you can see this. I have mentioned about some registry-related issues. The thing is, each of the WSO2 products, they have a registry inside. Registry is a database, but the stuff are represented as a file system. So there were, since we use this registry to store metadata of the applications and the APIs, we realized that some performance issues in the registry was causing issues for the users. So we investigated on those things, and we have been able to fix some of those issues, and we are still like working on that one. And for the problem with the increasing tenants, what we decided was like, okay, we are going to check whether these users are active for some period. If they are not active, we are going to send them a mail, and if they don't respond, we are going to remove them from the system. Their user will be there, but the organization we are going to remove with the artifacts and all those things. If they want, they can come back and log in, and they will have to create a new organization. So recently we did a cleanup, and we were able to remove a lot of tenants from the system. And the final thing is the processes. We know that different people are working in this system. So they apply patches, they do configuration changes, they do upgrades and migrations and all those things. Sometimes they make mistakes. But if the same mistake happens more than once, if they are doing the same mistake more than once, that means it's negligence. So we wanted to avoid that one. So for each of those identified places, came up with processes. For example, for applying a patch, first they have to test it in staging. Then they have to commit it into Puppet. And they have to install the pack freshly using Puppet. They can't just copy the patch and restart the server. They have to restart it using Puppet. So that kind of a process is there for patching. And for upgrades, like we came up with checklists because sometimes they do the correct thing in staging, and when it comes to live, they miss one or two steps, and then after the upgrade is done, it's not working in live. So as the doctors have checklists in the operation theaters or the operation theaters, we have checklists for the upgrades. So the person who is carrying out the upgrade has to make sure that each item is checked. So that's how we improved, we try to decrease the number of mistakes done by the human. So that's what we have been doing so far, and we have some future was coming with the integration cloud and the device cloud. So the integration cloud is ESB, the WSO2 ESB in the cloud. So we are going to make it more user friendly, and we are going to allow users to, so we are going to provide some templates, and then they can use those templates to do some integration scenarios. For example, they can get some their Twitter feeds and put it to a Google Doc kind of a thing. And then we are going to come up with the device cloud, which is that they can, this is powered by our the connected device manager product, which the users will be able to register their Raspberry Pis or any IoT products and manage them using the device cloud. Yeah, so that's it. So if you want to share this experience, or if you have further questions on this, you can reach me through this email, or you can reach me on Twitter as well. And yeah, so if you have any questions, I would like to answer. Yeah.
So a couple of questions. I think I'm trying to understand, you mentioned about AWS as your foundation.
Yes. Okay. Right.
So are the customers abstracted from that, or they have to deal with the
IT? No, they are abstracted from that one. They only so everything is taken care by us. They only have to do is they have to register in the cloud. By providing their email, and they can just using it. The App Cloud is totally free at the moment because it's in beta. For the API Cloud, there's a 14-day trial period, and after that, they can upgrade for a paid plan. They don't even know like where we are running, whether we are running in the AWS or not. So they are totally abstracted.
Totally abstracted.
Yes. Which APIs?
You mentioned about the components like RDS, EBS.
No, they are AWS stuff. RDS is, so the thing was like, so when we are setting up a deployment, so we need a database. So we can take an AWS instance and start a MySQL server in that one and use it, right? That's one thing. So then we have to manage that one. But AWS has a better feature called relational data storage or something. RDS stands for relational data storage, I think. In that one, we can just provision a database for us. So they do these, they take snapshots, backups, everything. So since we are in the AWS world, we thought of using that one because it's easy. And the Route 53 service, that's again their service. We can just simply go and put a DNS for, let's say, the apps.cloud.wso2.com. So we can just put it there and it starts working. Otherwise, like, we'll have to have our own DNS place and put the entry there. So we try to use the AWS services as much as possible because we are not an infrastructure company.
And how does it compare with something like Google Apps? Because I'm thinking in the same category, right?
Yes. Yes. The App Cloud is similar to Google App Engine. The only thing is, I think, in the Google App Engine, you get an instance for you, I think. And the same with Heroku. Heroku is very much similar to App Cloud. And for API Cloud, it is Apigee, Threescale. So those are the competitors, right? For this is very much similar to Google App Engine. I think App Engine has command line tool or something, I don't remember. So nothing much difference. So they also have these security policies, and they also restrict people from doing certain things. So very much similar.
And when you mentioned about 2,500 tenants or something, did you mean organizations?
Organizations. Yeah, so the thing is like, let's say I sign up to the cloud, right? I provide only my email, But our use cases are based on organizations, right? So after sign up, what we ask the users to do is, okay, provide the organization name and we will create an organization for you. An organization is equivalent to, is a tenant underneath the in underneath running system. So okay, you are using one organization now, and let's say you want to let's say you are a freelance developer. You are going to develop some APIs or apps for, let's say, Coca-Cola. And then you get a chance to do the same for Pepsi as well. So now you don't want to mess those two up. So you want to create a new organization. So we have a facility to add a new organization for you. And then, so now we are working in two organizations. So then you when you log into the cloud, we display the two organizations and ask, okay, which organization you want to go in today? So if you select Coca-Cola, you are taken to that organization. And then you will see the apps you created for that one. And you can also invite one person to Coca-Cola organization and invite another person to the Pepsi organization. So that use case is very very strongly implemented. Right. Any other questions? OK, right. I think the time's up and yeah. So if you have any questions, you can reach out to me. I'll be in the WSO2 stall, and yeah, you can talk to me. I'll be happy to share the experience we had. Thank you.